Against a Conspiracy is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown and community supported. For a list of other fun programming, please check out the albertapodcastnetwork.com, where you can find shows like Two and Out, CFL.
Blue 42! Flip, flip, hut, hut, hut!
I love that announcement, man. That's so good.
I was messing with settings before we started, so I think maybe I clicked something.
You've turned something on.
Yeah. Well, this time it didn't ask me if I was okay with the recording. So,
are you okay with this recording?
Really turned something on here.
Episode 22, The Good Death. Welcome back, yeah. Everyone, to It's Conspiracy. This is the podcast where we lay out the beliefs behind selected conspiracy theories, alternative accounts, legends, myths, and more. I'm your host, Andrew, and I do not claim to be an expert on anything we're going to discuss today, and we'll probably be wrong about everything because it's our last regular episode of the season. We still have our bonus episode, though, which is regular in that we've done it twice, but not a regular episode in that we'll have guests and follow a different format. Not that there's anything wrong with other people or following a different format. That's fine. You do you, and there's nothing wrong with you doing yourself. Anyways, so that's not... Yeah, sorry. This is our last episode of the season. I should have just left it with that. Yeah. wow. I don't know what's going on here. If you'd like to see where we dug up whatever crusty crabs we're about to burst open and feast on, then please check out the resources in the episode description. Charlie has worked tremendously hard all season long without ever complaining, despite the cruel hours, outrageous demands, and constant inappropriate comments from our office staff. Thank you for doing that, Charlie. You are just a real neat guy. Real neat.
Thank you. You'll be hearing from HR, though.
This is on top of him running Command Central during our meetings with the recording and being a sharpshooter with the jokes.
Sniper.
And we should mention that the office staff is actually his lovely wife, who I would invite her to make inappropriate comments.
That's true. Yeah. No. Yeah. That's the one place where it's encouraged.
Yeah, yep. For sure.
I think her bonus is actually structured around her making, you know, inappropriate comments. Yeah. Pretty sure we put that in her contract.
That's right.
And we are a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network. So awesome. So friends. So team, so squad.
Go team.
You can check us out at itsaconspiracypodcast.com. Our Twitter, at Is It A Conspiracy? That's run by the social media influencer, the Irish Madman. Our Facebook group and our wonderful Instagram page, It's A Conspiracy Podcast. That's run by Greg. Thank you again, Greg, for doing that. You're doing a great job. And it's just a bit of the magic. Ooh. There was a hashtag you put on there yesterday, and it, like, I legit laughed out loud. I was like, that is so funny. I don't remember
beards
what it
for
was.
Beards for everybody?
Yeah, beards for everybody.
Yeah, we had like a good 5 minutes where we talked about how I can grow a beard, and Charlie grows some wicked mutton chops, and you look like a 12-year-old child.
Yeah, that's quite true. Finally, we also have our Patreon page, patreon.com/
It's a conspiracy.
But wait, Andrew, that's not all. I know it's a little late in the season to be springing new things on you, but if you're tired of just tapping your fingers along the keyboard and sending us those kind of messages, why not give us a phone call on the brand new Conspiracy Hotline? You can call 1-780-851-8785 and leave us all sorts of messages. Tell us what you like about the episodes. Tell us if we missed something. Tell us if you know about, you know, the God particle we talked about last episode and didn't correctly talk about. Maybe you got some other insight for us. Get at us and just call 1-780-851-8785.
What was that number again?
1-780-851-8785.
Oh, man. So for today, joining the online distance communication time today is Charlie Scream and Gorgeous Greg with his beautiful long eyelashes. What's up? Is your eye okay now? Is it all right?
Eye's fine now. Okay. My mustache is too long and it's getting in my mouth.
It's the Sunday of a long weekend and really exciting, even though I don't know. I have to go to work on Tuesday. Do you guys? Tuesday?
Yeah, back to the grind.
I'm working every day.
Yeah. So let's just
taking
enjoy.
Taking care of business.
ETB, baby.
Anywho, these party mix pals will interject as they see fit. And I am so just gosh darn grateful for their digital company, Dag Nabbit. Now, Charlie, with a simple yes or no, or perhaps, can you tell me if you've heard of Trither of these theories?
Perhaps.
Number one, the moon isn't real.
Yes.
Okay. Number two, moments of Greg with Greg.
Perhaps.
Okay. Number three, who murdered Walt Disney?
No.
Oh. Now, this is the one, Greg. I know Greg knows this one already, so I'm like,
hey, I don't actually.
You don't know this one? You're going to know.
When fresh.
When I start talking about it, you'll be like, is this the one where?
Damn it. Yeah. I was waiting to do that trope later, but I guess you ruined it.
You saved some big hitters for the series final here.
Oh, man. You know, I think last season we might have ended with Disney as well, or begat with Disney a couple times. Was Walt Disney real?
Is his head frozen underneath Disneyland?
All right, subject number one, the moon isn't real.
Finally, get ready for some serious moon action.
The moon. It's my favorite of Earth's moons, and it's a spectacle to see. And we are quite unique in our solar system in that we only have one. It's okay to play favorites when there is only one. So maybe previous to this era, there was some kind of Highlander situation, and the current moon beheaded a bunch of other moons, and it has all the knowledge of the other moons. That's probably how it worked. But either way, it can have children and grow old with a partner, and it's a moon. That's good.
Wow, that's a throwback to like season one there, man. We haven't talked about Highlander in I don't know how long.
Oh, man. You know, the other day I read this thing about how Henry Cavill is going to be in the reboot of Highlander, and I'm like, I'm okay with that, but like, I don't know.
They're doing a reboot.
Apparently. As long as this time, if you're going to get a Scottish guy to be the Scottish guy, get the Scottish guy. And if you're going to get, like in Highlander 1, you've got a Scottish guy playing like an Egyptian Spanish guy, and a guy from like Belgium or whatever being a Scottish guy.
Like the France.
Yeah. Is he from France?
Lambert.
He's French.
I'm Christophe Lambert. I don't think so.
Is that from, no, that's from, anyway. The moon
that
isn't
was
real.
Actually holy. Like spot on.
I know, but I can't, what so movie good. Is that from where he's like, I don't think so. And he's dressed up as like a monk.
Highlander 3?
No, it's like a Mortal Kombat, I think, or like a Street Fighter movie, but it's not Street Fighter. And in the end, he's like, I don't think so.
Charlie, you've got this look on your face. Like,
yeah.
Let's just go with perhaps.
There are a number of moon theories out there because it's there and people don't quite understand what's happening. So was it part of the Earth? Was it a planet of its own? Did human beings ever really land there? Do we have more than one moon, aka the Black Knight satellite moonlit theory? Were the Transformers ancestors discovered up there? Are the Transformers movies bad? Could Optimus Prime fly the entire time and just save it until the end of the one? These theories are far-fetched as they may be, and I think we can all agree on one thing, and that is that the moon does exist. Or does it?
God, you're really putting a whole lot of questions out there, you know that?
That's right. And it,
yeah, man.
We've touched on a lot of things here already. There is a theory known as the fake moon theory, or the moon is fake theory, the hollow moon theory, or officially the Vaskin Shcherbakov theory. I feel that's how we would say Shcherbakov.
Oh, okay.
So, Shcherbakov, Shcherbakov, which is fun to say. Yeah. So
the
Shcherbakov theory.
Oh.
Yeah. That old chestnut. It posits that the moon is in fact a giant alien spacecraft. Now, this theory, just like Karl Marx, was developed in Soviet Russia by two scientists. Their names were Vassin and Shcherbakov, and they did their thing in the 1970s. Their theory, officially titled, Is the Moon the Creation of an Alien Intelligence?, suggests that the moon that we know was hollowed out by an ancient civilization that was far superior to anything known on Earth. Or, and this is the theory that I would subscribe to myself, not to take sides, but this is the one. There is a ship inside that is projecting like a hologram to make it look like our friendly spherical lunar neighbor. So it's either a hollow rock or it's a spaceship with like a camouflage moon cloak. Now, What reasons do they have for suggesting this? Aside from being incredibly awesome, the moon is covered in very shallow craters, which are out of character with other moons that we know of. So if our moon is the same age as the rest of the universe, roughly, then it should have been pockmarked by the same amount of asteroid and comet activity, and any crash sites, wow, that's hard to say, should be much deeper than they are. So our moon has a lot of marks, but compared to other moons, it's like nothing at all. And all of the craters are really, really shallow. So this suggests that either the moon hasn't been hit that often because it's new, or it's an outlier of statistics, or there is a ship below the projection that is protecting the surface. So the comets and asteroids are just bouncing off of the spaceship. Anything lands there, it just like gets deflected. And that's
rubber and glue sort of, you know, I'm rubber, you're glue kind of thing, bouncing off the moon. Anything you say sticks to me and bounces off the moon. That's the old saying, right?
That's what they say. Now, I'm sure we can agree that the spaceship here, this is the one that we're going to go with for this. Like, that's amazing. Just a, yeah.
I'll allow it.
Okay. Thank you for that, Charlie. Now, perhaps most interesting about this theory is the further suggestion that there is a dome or a void inside the moon approximately 20 miles down from the surface that contains or contained an atmosphere where this like ancient civilization are just hanging out, watching us all like a couple of creeps with their telescopes and binoculars, keeping an eye on the Earth people. In 1976, George H. Leonard published a book, Someone Else is on the Moon, in which he shared a number of NASA photographs in which large construction machinery can clearly be seen. NASA, surprisingly, has not ever responded to these claims. And this, if you guys are Transformers fans, this is the plot for Transformers Dark of the Moon. And I know it's a low standard, but that's probably the worst one. I've only sat through a few of them, and they all blended together into just a bunch of aliens wrestling around. Yeah,
you know, I think I've seen most of them, and I agree. They all sort of just meld together.
They do. Yeah. This might be the one where Optimus Prime, like Marky Mark, is saying goodbye, and Optimus Prime flies away like he had jets the entire time. And wasn't a truck.
And then the screen flashes to a card that says, Optimus Prime has flown back to his home planet.
That moment really has just stuck in my brain and made me mad. Okay, so here, I'm just going to share a picture here from George H. Leonard's book. So here we go. He's like, look, it's a picture of the moon. What's this here, if not an ancient
civilization
construction? Yes, yeah. And look at these borderlines. This is where the buildings were. Yeah. Never
mind
that.
That doesn't look like the
moon. That doesn't look like the moon at all.
It looks like Area 51.
It looks like Kansas or something.
Let's put our opinions back in our pants, gentlemen.
That was more like an opinion pocket.
That was more like a claim than an opinion.
Yeah. Just like you're claiming that that the moon is a spaceship with a cloaking shield on. Same thing, buddy.
Oh, that really does look like maybe somebody zoomed in on like a basketball or something. But in the 1990s, author David Weber wrote a series called Heirs of Empire, in which a giant spaceship from a planet far, far away ran out of fuel and came to rest in Earth's orbit. The inhabitants of the ship made their way down to the planet, and they're our ancestors. So that's where we come from. We came from the spaceship that got stuck in Earth's orbit.
Aliens.
This always sounded a lot like the Death Star to me. And there's probably some kind of copyright lawsuit brewing. Now, the reason I make this up is, you guys, this is amazing. So I bring this up. It's attached to the theory, but also the author, David Weber, he has to be the template for John Goodman's character in The Big Lebowski.
Oh. Okay.
So I'm going to blow some minds here, you guys. So you bet. Get your anchors tied on because you're going to get blown away here.
Bring it, man.
Right. Check this out. Look at that.
Yeah,
right? Come on.
Oh, Jesus.
That's amazing.
Just not John Goodman?
If this is David Weber on the left, that's John Goodman, Big Lebowski on the right. The hair, the jacket, everything.
So good.
Yes. And that movie is fantastic. So
one of my favorite. No, my favorite. Absolute all-time favorite.
Is it your favorite movie?
That's the one.
Top five.
You like it more than National Treasure? Charlie?
Look, that is a myth. Since we're on the grand final of season three, let's talk about that myth for a quick second. That's not my favorite movie, Andy. You decided that.
Kind of sounds like an opinion to me.
Oh, I'll say, fine, I'll bring it back up. I'll make a note.
Make a note. Notes being made. We're getting written up.
There. Sending that to HR.
So anyways, that's the Vazin Shcherbakov theory, or the Hollow Moon.
Rolls right off the tongue.
Yeah. Greg,
what are we drinking?
I'm keeping it on the caffeine train.
Uh-oh.
I like to drink it out of my It's a Conspiracy coffee mug, where you can get it at
oldmandesign.com.
We'll get you sorted.
Love it.
How about you, Andrew? What are you drinking?
I am drinking.
Doing it live.
We're doing it live, and this is what I had last evening, and these guys are great. I think I've talked about Endeavor Brewing before. Endeavor Brewing are a Edmonton, I think they're based in St. Albert, actually, but an Edmonton area brewery. And I had one of these sweet mamas. It's called a Lost Flip Flop Saison. The Lost Flip Flop is the perfect patio beer. It is fermented with a traditional French saison yeast, but that's where the tradition ends. A healthy dose of Citra and Sorachi Ace hops give this beer a strong citrus, lemony, and tropical aroma. The aroma and flavor make this a very refreshing beer on warm summer days. Did you guys notice yesterday that it was a warm summer-esque kind of day?
It was a beautiful day.
It was
nice.
It was real nice.
Pasta carbonara al fresco.
Oh yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Molto bene.
Treat yourself.
Did you do the chef's kiss thing a couple times?
I couldn't, man. It was just the sun, the atmosphere, the food.
Mm-hmm.
It was lost.
That sounds so good. And Charles, what are we drinking?
Well, I'll tell you, I'm drinking a Blind Man River Session Ale brewed in Lacombe, Alberta from Blind Man Brewing. And you know what's more? I'm drinking it out of my It's a Conspiracy mug that's available at oldmandesign.com. We'll get you sorted.
Yeah, I'm drinking out of a coffee cup. It's coffee.
Drinking beer out of a coffee mug.
Beer cognito.
Ah, that is beautiful. And man, Blind Man Brewing, so good. I was telling Greg this the other night, was that I was at my liquor store and I noticed these adorable little things called, they were barley wine. And so a couple of episodes ago, Greg had mentioned he'd had barley wine. They're tiny little cans. They're like 200 milliliter cans. They're just the cutest little things. I should have got a picture. I should have bought some.
You should have bought some. They're delicious.
Man, when I go in there, I'm like, I'm getting this one thing and I'm getting out of there because it's just like,
no, it's so easy to just pick up like five different things. And
yeah, totally. Sure. And I got to stick to my budget.
Do I feed my kids or do I drink the beer?
And that's a serious debate. I'm like, what the kids? You know, whatever. Like,
they can always drink the beer.
We've got lots of ketchup rice at home. They can have.
Anytime I go into the liquor store, somebody once years ago compared it to the scene in Charlotte's Web where Templeton the rat goes to the fair and he's like, oh, look at everything. Just like eating like banana peels on the ground. And you're just like, ugh. So
liquor stores, just like rats at the county fair.
That's going to take us to ad number one.
Hi there. I'm Brendan, a certified home inspector with Roomy. Do you have a problem that needs fixing? Whether it's big or small, inside or outside, let me help you find out what's really going on. You can call me by phone, or we can take a look together over video chat. Visit roomi.ca, that's roomi.ca, and go to Ask a Home Inspector to book your appointment with me today.
Moments of Greg.
Oh, wasn't that majestic? Thank you, Kendra. That was absolutely beautiful.
Brilliant.
Okay.
Feeling it.
So take us away.
So Moments of Greg, the first segment. I was going to do some other stuff, but then I ended up reminiscing about my wonderful young life that I have. And I don't think I've ever mentioned to you the time that I was recruited and entered and worked for a cult here in Edmonton.
What?
Are you serious?
So when I first moved back to Edmonton at the ripe old age of 20, which was about 10 years ago now, I ended up staying here for a month beforehand. And during that month, I ended up working 40 hours a week the entire time. I think I maybe had 5 total days off of this 1 month vacation that I was trying to take, where I ended up working at the Holes Greenhouse outside of St. Albert. And there was a company there called Health Hub Holdings. And they ended up owning the spa and kind of like, you know, a workout, yoga, rich people feel good about yourself kind of thing company. And they also own the restaurant there. And I used to be a chef, just for reference for everybody. That's kind of where I got my start. Little did I know that Health Hub Holdings is closely tied to a man named John DeRuiter.
Oh, what?
Who I know who is.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Who is a Canadian non-dualist author. And he conducts meetings here in Edmonton, Alberta, and abroad, where basically you just basically sit in a room and stare at him staring back at you.
Yeah, that's what people do, man. They pay huge money for this. Yeah.
So a majority of the people that I worked with at Health Hub Holdings were people from Europe. I think I had a person from Hungary, Germany, Belgium, France. There was one guy, but there was 10 women that worked for this guy and basically just dropped their entire life, their everything they had going on in whatever country, family they were living with, moved to Edmonton on the whim that John DeRuiter had told him to come here through his fiery eyes, staring gaze. And this was where they needed to be where they're at in their life.
Huh.
Yeah. So if I'm going to share some stuff. I'm just going to share a photo of John DeRuiter.
Of Health Hub Holdings?
I kind of scrounged the internet for it. And I think I found like a LinkedIn profile that was like deleted 10 years ago.
Oh, no way. Okay.
But here, yeah. And then I'll give you guys some background on Mr. John DeRuiter.
Have you heard of this guy before, Charlie?
I've not heard of this at all.
Oh, man. Yeah.
So you guys see it?
There he is.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. So this is John DeRuiter. Very intense fellow.
Yeah. That's just his resting face, too.
That's just his resting face. Have you seen him smile?
Wow.
There he is, smiling like a normal human being. Yeah.
Yeah. Very normal human smile.
Yes.
So I'm going to stop sharing.
Humans like to smile.
Oh, man. So just while I'm looking up some information on John DeRuiter here, I did not know about this when I first moved to Edmonton. I was working with the company. We were at the time called Prairie Kitchen or something like that, or Prairie Bistro. My sister was the general manager there. I just thought I was working with some amazing, really nice people. Little did I know what I was getting myself into.
Yeah.
So John DeRuiter, like I said, he is a non-dualist author. I have no idea what that means, but I think it's pretty deep. He operates in a center called the College of Integrated Philosophy. However, the organization cannot legally be considered a college as it is not formally accredited by the Canadian Alberta government. This conducts his seminars and lectures from the Oasis Center here in Edmonton, which is a large auditorium where it's mostly weddings and events that are conducted there. Notably, John DeRuiter has been implicated in a number of public controversies, including accusations of being a cult leader by multiple independent news outlets and a civil lawsuit in which he was sued by 2 sisters who allege he was in a 3-way common law marriage with both women simultaneously. DeRuiter has been accused by former followers of using faith-based claims to coerce them into sexual acts as well. So when I was 20 years old, I was brought into this company and went to a couple of meetings where this guy just basically sat there and stared at us. There were 2 giant screens where you just saw his face and he looked at you and like didn't say anything, barely blinked, barely moved. And I have no idea what I was doing there.
So you were in one of these meetings and you saw a video of him just looking at everybody.
And like I've talked to like a couple of the women that were there, and like when I say like they dropped their entire lives, like these people barely spoke English. Like they came to Canada with nothing. They came for this man because whatever he was giving them, they were loving it.
Wow. What?
Yeah.
Holy. And this guy's based out of Edmonton, which doesn't seem like when you think of stories like this, you think of like bigger. I don't know. Do you know what I mean? Like not to shoot down Edmonton, but
I mean, sometimes you think about bigger places, but sometimes you think about smaller communities that, you know, that these kind of people can find a good foothold in and like decent parcels of land for good prices, right? So that you can afford to bring your commune or your pseudo cult and have them all housed in the same, same area.
That's wild.
Well, I have a couple more controversies that I'd like to read about as well, because this guy is just so interesting. Controversy concerning the movement arose in 1999 when, at a public meeting, DeRuiter's wife confronted him after learning that he was involved with two daughters of a devotee who was invested into the organization. And when they mean invested, they mean lots and lots of money. The sisters themselves, followers of DeRuiter, would later sue him. These are the ones that were in common law marriage simultaneously. Where is this? In a sworn affidavit from Benita von Sass, which I would imagine is either a follower or one of the women that he was involved with, alleged that he claimed to be Christ on earth, and defying him was to defy truth, goodness, and God. Accordingly, I obeyed and submitted. Further controversy arose in 2014 after the death of one of DeRuiter's female followers under mysterious circumstances in 2017. And DeRuiter publicly admitted that he had had sex with a number of his female followers. He was referred to this as the calling. Like, just, I couldn't believe that I was involved with this, as I had no idea what was going on until years and years later. Someone was like, hey, you like look him up, check it out. And I found all this information. I was like, holy moly.
Did you ever talk to him? Like one-on-one?
I met him once at the restaurant. He came in to eat and I was just like, I don't have time for this idiot. What the fuck? He's gonna stare at me for 45 minutes. Nobody's gonna eat any food. The restaurant will be closed and then we all have to go home. You know? It was super weird experience. Super weird meeting all these people who just literally were so devoted to him. And this is not an accusation. This is a real thing. He basically just did not pay any rent at the Holes Greenhouse in St. Albert. And they ended up losing like millions and millions of dollars because of it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So please don't sue me. This is not an accusation. This is, you know, I don't have a lawyer and I don't make that much money. You're not going to get anything.
Well, this is a matter of public record, right?
I just want to say that. Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, this is all public knowledge, I think. Yeah.
So they're not still operating at the
I believe he still is. I don't know where or what he's doing specifically, mainly because like I jumped out of that not knowing that I was already in it.
Yeah. You don't send each other Christmas cards or anything like that.
Yeah. No. And I've never seen any of these people that were involved with him ever. So either they disappeared as well or they went back to where they came from or.
Yeah, but like it's called the Enjoy Center, which just cracks me up every time I hear it. So it's
not that joyful, trust me.
Yeah, but it was sold 2019. I remember just before everything went crazy with the lockdown, I was out there. I did a gig out there and for a wedding, which now is, I know what restaurant you're talking about.
Yeah, and I think it's called the Glasshouse Bistro or something now.
Yeah, and the food was awesome. It was a beautiful building. But I don't remember anything like this at all. But at the time, there was people saying that it was being sold. So I just looked it up and it was sold in 2019. I would imagine they probably split ways with anything to do with this guy.
Oh yeah. But this happened back in, 2011, 2012.
In the before times.
Before we got into the black hole.
Man.
But that was my experience and introduction to a cult. It was great.
The look of joy on your face really brings me. Yeah,
that's one hell of an inaugural moment of Greg.
Right on, man. Well, that's going to take us to subject number three: Who murdered Walt Disney?
Who?
In a previous episode, we discussed the long-running theory that Walt Disney, founder of Walt Disney, was on the brink of death and decided to have his body placed in cryogenic storage, or perhaps just his head after it had been removed Highlander style. He also might have had some horrible political leanings, nobody's really sure. Like Howard Hughes or the Rockefellers, Disney led an incredible life, and a number of details of his life are scrutinized by theorists. Details that were scrutinized are things like what happened with the stories behind the scene, how these movies were made. He's enormously successful at the Oscars. I think he still has the record for the most nominations. And was he murdered? So Disney was a heavy smoker for most of his life. He was diagnosed with lung cancer in 1966 and had began taking cobalt therapy. This is where gamma rays, yes, the kind that turn you into an Incredible Hulk, are shot into your body by external beam radiotherapy. Part of this process of the machine was actually developed at the University of Saskatchewan by Dr. Harold Johns. So don't let anyone tell you that Saskatchewan is entirely worthless. Oh, man. The endless barrage of radiation Disney went through weakened him to the point that after only a few weeks of this treatment, he was unable to move. He did continue working on his final project, which was The Jungle Book, right up until he collapsed, and he complained of pains in his neck and back. He was taken to hospital where he died of circulatory failure shortly after, or maybe he was frozen and his body's kept in a vault in Disneyland, or maybe just his head. Anyway, before he died, he was displaying a number of symptoms, including nausea, vomiting, stiffness, and everybody's favorite, diarrhea.
Hooray!
Yeah, I know. How great is that? These are the common treats. The common traits of chemotherapy. So the chemotherapy traits, not the chemo treats. Yeah, the chemotherapy traits. And they are also the traits of someone who may have been poisoned. We need to get Angela Lansbury in here. Let's rewind for a second. Disney was getting increasingly sick and was basically taken to the hospital directly from his office, where he had continued to work right up until he collapsed. So the story goes, he's working at his desk. He calls out to his assistant to come and help him. His assistant runs into the room. Disney is clearly in pain. He's writing something down on a piece of paper, and then he collapses. The story is that the assistant got him to the hospital, called an ambulance, whatever, and that Disney really didn't regain consciousness before passing away a few weeks later. With the cancer diagnosis, when he was taken to the hospital, everybody's like, oh, this is looking grim. After he passed away, his office was being cleaned out and his records were being archived. The assistant who had been called in when Disney collapsed noticed. He's like, oh, that's that scrap of paper that Walt Disney was writing on, and it was still sitting on his desk.
Oh, I know what it says.
It says, don't say it. Don't
please,
say it.
Please clear my browser history.
Oh, I thought you were actually going to. That would have been great. The assistant had assumed it would be a sketch for The Jungle Book or something like that, maybe a new project. And he was shocked to see that there was actually a name scrawled onto the paper. And that name was none other. This is true. That name was Kurt Russell.
I did know that.
I know. It's, yeah. Kurt Russell, one of our favorite actors here at It's a Conspiracy Club. He grew up in the Disney movie mill and was an incredibly popular child star. Perhaps Disney considered Russell a friend. Perhaps there was a movie role coming up. Or perhaps he was trying to pass on the identity of his killer. Here's a quote from Kurt Russell. We did have a personal relationship. We played ping pong at lunch sometimes. He'd come down to the set. We'd go watch movies that the studio was making, and he'd come down and ask if I wanted to go see them. He took me around and introduced me to all the different departments at Disney, and at one point gave me a bunch of original photo cells that they make the backdrop drawings of the characters and stuff like that. So he had a relationship with...
Did you just drop in a clip of Kurt Russell saying that?
Yeah. I thought that was Snake Plissken, man.
At the time, Kurt Russell, was a teenager trying to get out of his 10-year contract with Disney. So he was 16, 17 years old, and he had recently signed on to go all the way up until his late 20s. And he had had sights set on becoming a professional baseball player, and he was getting tired of being in movies like The Computer Wore Tennis Shoes and The Barefoot Executive and Follow Me, Boys. So Disney had tried to persuade him to stick with acting, but Russell was determined to do something else with his life. Skeptics have suggested that it's possible that Russell, trying to get out of his contract, may have poisoned Disney. Or, and perhaps this is a little bit more likely, some spoilers coming up here, Kurt Russell is, in fact, in real life, Ego the Living Planet, and gave Walt Disney cancer just like he gave Star-Lord's mom cancer in that movie, Guardians of the Galaxy 2. Spoilers. Sorry about that. Do you guys know what I'm talking about?
I do.
Yeah,
I do. You see the connection there?
Yeah.
And I do love that movie. Also, it is a matter of public record that Disney was being monitored by the U.S. government at the time due to a number of political statements, which is true. It's crazy, but it's true. They were keeping an eye on him. And perhaps Russell was a CIA mole at the organization.
Oh, he was a sleeper agent.
A sleeper agent, that's right. As of 2015, on permanent display at Disneyland, there is a completely intact setting of Walt Disney's office as it was on the day he died. In the office is a collection of original scripts and notes, and some people have claimed that the scrap of paper, the one that was found, is in fact in these notes. Somebody has posted this picture, and I'm sure it's entirely reliable. It was either on Reddit or 4chan or something like that, so I'm sure it's real. Like, no need to, you know.
Those are real places, Andrew.
Let me just take a look. A peek-see.
I'm impressed you did some dark web digging.
Don't tell anybody. So this is it. This is the note here. Okay. A little hard to see, but there's a bunch of like stuff typed up here. And then he's written down a few names. And if you look right here, it says Kurt Russell. And then directly underneath it, it says CIA Mobley. And we'll come back to that in a second.
I thought it said Bob Marley.
Bob Marley.
That seems a little more legit, actually.
Yeah. What's that? There's that movie where the guy's like, he's reading a quote and he's like, and then, and it's like, oh, he must have died while he was writing this. That's actually what it says. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Was that Monty Python?
That might have been Monty Python.
Yeah.
He's like, yeah. Now, if you look at this, there's that little line going off at the end. So maybe like he actually died writing
that.
Yeah. Just a throaty groan at the end there. All right. So there's two things to note about this. So after Kurt Russell, the name CIA Mobley is written. Number two, it is important to note, just like in Kill Bill, there's a number of names written here and they are all in red ink. This, according to a number of Asian cultures, is a cursed way of representing someone's name. It means that they will die young. And that is the kind of thing you would wish upon the conspirators that poisoned you, perhaps. Okay, so he was putting together a to-kill list. And here's five fun facts about Kurt Russell. Okay. So, number one, Kurt Russell was basically cast as Han Solo or maybe Luke Skywalker and was doing screen tests with other actors trying out for the part. He eventually had enough of the delays in production, apparently didn't like George Lucas, and he quit to do a very, totally bomb movie called The Quest. So a Western called The Quest. Give up Han Solo to be in The Quest.
Should have called it The Question.
Number two, in 1994's Stargate, Kurt Russell was paid double his asking price. And the producers were like, look, we're not too sure of this script. We really need a win. And you are the most likable person, which I would agree with that. He is tremendously likable. And they were like, we'll pay you double. Just really turn on the charm. Turn on the old Russell juice. And let's get you winning over the audiences. That movie's kind of crap. The TV series is better. I don't know, Greg.
That flat top is fucking beautiful, baby.
He does have an amazing head of hair in that movie. Number three, Russell stealth directed the Western masterpiece Tombstone. The director, George Cosmatos, I don't know if that's a fake name or what, but Cosmatos, this director had done the same thing before with Sylvester Stallone on 1985's Rambo First Blood Part 2. Yay. So he let the actor like take over. He's like, I don't really know what I'm doing. Why don't you shoot the movie from here?
Do the thing.
Number four, 1977, Russell got his pilot's license. And on an early flight, he reported seeing a UFO over Phoenix. Here's another quote, Charlie. This is me this time. Okay. I saw six lights over the airport in absolute uniform in a V shape. This was officially made public during an interview.
Kurt.
In 2015. I know. Crazy.
He's right here.
Number five. One of Kurt Russell's first roles ever was in an Elvis movie. In 1963, the movie It Happened at the World's Fair featured a six-year-old boy running up and kicking Elvis in the shin.
That's him.
That was Kurt Russell, yeah. Since then, Russell has gone on to play the King in a number of roles, including 3,000 Miles to Graceland, Forrest Gump, and a movie called Elvis from 1979, where Russell was actually nominated for an Emmy. So it's almost like they switched spirits at that moment. And Elvis put his Elvis-ness into a young Kurt Russell.
That's a hell of a kick.
Yeah. Bonus fact, Snake Plissken is Russell's favorite role, and he insisted on wearing the legendary eye patch during the filming of Escape from New York and Escape from L.A. and
Captain Ron.
It's the same eye patch. Apparently, he borderline insisted on wearing it again for The Hateful Eight, and Quentin Tarantino's like, look, no, it's like, I love you very much, but like, let's lose the eye patch. You know,
you just destroyed a $50,000 guitar. Keep your eye patch at home.
That seems like a missed opportunity. Cause that to me seems like something that would be right up Tarantino's alley.
You'd think so, wouldn't it? Yeah. I don't know what to tell you, but I just love it. Or maybe it was the other way around. Maybe Tarantino was like, look,
hey man, can you wear that eye patch?
Put the eye patch on. And Kurt's like, I don't think so, man. I've had enough of that eye patch. It's super itchy. I'm afraid one day I'll take it out and it'll suck my eye right out of my skull.
That's the biggest fear with eye patches, I think.
Mm-hmm. I know we're not in opinions time yet, but I have to get this off my chest in an official platform here. We have our Friday night movie group, and we all get together and friends, and we watch films. My most recent choice, we all take turns picking movies. I picked Escape from LA thinking it would be hilariously bad and laughable.
It was
terrible. The where he was surfing down the alley on like the CG tsunami, that was amazing. But there's a scene in there where he slowly like walks over to a chair and sits down. It's like a 5-minute scene of him just like, oh, and like slowly just groaning like an old man, just like, oh, feels good to sit down. I'm like, what? This is an action movie, man.
My old bones.
It was a few years before The Matrix, which kind of changed action movies, but like, man, I hated that movie. Anyway,
I'm still going to stand by my point that the soundtrack is amazing.
Oh, so good, man. So good. Yeah, the soundtrack is the best part. You know, in a movie full of like, like eye patches and like amputee prostitutes and machine guns and hang gliders and like explosions, how could it be boring? Like, how could it be boring? But it was so boring. Oh, anyway.
Oh, boy. Well, it sounds like we just jumped right into opinion time, so.
That's Ed number. Anyways, was Walt Disney murdered and Kurt Russell's great? Okay, that's ad number two.
With Pod Power, our sponsors are making it possible for us to amplify the voices of Albertans and Alberta podcasters. This episode, Edmonton Community Foundation is helping us give a Pod Power shout out to Is This For Real? Is This For Real is a podcast about various facets of Black life in Edmonton. In the first season of the show, Breaking the Blue Wall, host Omar Salafu explores anti-Black racism and policing and tells stories about policing in schools, accountability in Alberta's policing system, and the impacts of police violence on Black Edmontonians. You can listen to the podcast and read more about each episode at isthisforreal.ca. You can also support the work of these podcasters and future seasons on Patreon.
Man, you had so little time to wait to get over to opinion time.
I know. I just couldn't. Like,
oh, boom.
Opinion time. Hey, everybody, it's opinion time.
I had to get it off of my chest. So, Greg, what was our first theory? Do you remember what our first theory was?
The moon doesn't exist, and if it does, it is hollow or a astral projection of an alien ship.
That's right. Discovered by a guy who is the visual basis for The Big Lebowski.
Yeah. Norm, I think his name was.
Was his name Norm? That's a perfect name if it is. Is it Donnie?
Wait, who are you talking about? The character in...
I'm thinking John Goodman in Big Lebowski.
Oh, I think it's
Donnie's there. Walter. Walter.
Yeah, Walter.
Oh, man. And our second thing was Greg and that time he worked for the cult. And not the rockin' 80s band, but Edmonton.
I wish.
Oh, that would have been amazing. And Charlie, what was our third option, our third theory here?
Our third option today was Walt Disney murdered? And, well, sub note, was it Kurt Russell who did the murdering?
So I don't know, Charlie, do you have any thoughts on the moon not existing, like space being fake in general?
No, the moon is real. I can see it sometimes during the day.
Yeah, right.
It's going to have to be a pretty big LED lit object for it to light my evening strolls.
Mm-hmm. Well, so, you know, it could be hollow, though. Hard to see.
Could be hollow, but even if it's hollow, it doesn't make it less of a thing. It's still a thing. It's just a hollow thing. Are chocolate Easter bunnies non-existent because they are hollow pieces of chocolate? No, they still exist.
That's an interesting point. So even if it is a spaceship projecting like a camouflage moon thing, it is still a moon, you're saying?
Still a moon.
Still a moon?
It's still in orbit.
Yeah. All right.
Maybe they hollowed it out and they have little, little skinny dipping moon parties on their moon resorts and they're looking at us through their moon telescopes, you know. But still a moon.
Yeah, and there could be somebody up there, right? Like an ancient civilization just still keeping an eye on things.
Sure.
Yeah. All right. That sounds like you've done your research on this. Greg, what do you think?
Well, you made the comment, and I think you were just going for a fact here, but I could be wrong, that the moon was like as old as the universe, which it's not.
Oh, no. So, okay. So just to clear that up, what it was that the moon must be much newer because it has been, it's been hit by asteroids and meteorites and whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like a lot and less than like every other moon that we've that scientists have looked at.
I'm going to drop some fake physics knowledge that I have on you. And, you know, the Earth is roughly the same age as the moon and is a much larger object with a much larger gravitational pull that would pull these objects towards the Earth and away from the moon, wouldn't it?
In English.
Yeah, right. Sorry. No, but that's my thing. I'm like, it just seems kind of light. I really wish you'd have brought up the fact that it might be made of cheese. There's just no way to confirm it.
Sure. Some cheese moon. That's part of the one of the associated theories about the moon is that it's all
Gouda to me.
Yeah.
Hey, Greg, did you say that the moon is older than the Earth?
No, I said they're roughly the same age.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I mean, if memory serves me correctly, the moon is about 4.53 billion years old and the Earth.
Yeah, the Earth is like 4.56.
Yeah, 4.543 kind of thing going on.
Yeah.
So, well, there's also, the sort of one of the going theories is that the moon is actually a broken off piece of the Earth. That's a big contested subject, I think, in the sciences.
Yeah, they were like conjoined twins in the womb and then they were born and, you know, the moon was just like, you know, a less formed brother.
Did you have a co-joined twin, Charlie, that's locked up in your attic?
Nope. Still inside me. Never unconjoined.
Never unconjoined.
And I'll never
together
let you out.
Forever.
We have weekly chats and are talking about starting a new podcast.
Another Judas podcast. Charles.
Welcome to the Judas cast then.
Oh, wow. I guess as for this John DeRuiter thing, Greg, I think it's hilarious that you actually got to meet him. And it's really funny just being like, I'm here to, you know, fry up some onion rings and flip some burgers, friends. And it turns out it's like this crazy cult. Like,
all the signs were there that it was a cult. It's like I went there for vacation. What did I do? I ended up working my ass off the entire time. We had staff meetings where what I said, we would stare in silence at each other for 5 minutes. And then after that 5 minutes, it would be like, how do you feel? And the first time we did that, I was like, I feel like this is a waste of time. I have a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
Did you actually say that?
I did say that. And then I was never asked to come to a staff meeting again.
The second you left, they were like, he is not one of us. No. Yeah.
No. Pretty much. Yep.
Put him back in the kitchen.
Dude.
Put him back in the kitchen. Yeah. But like, I, just like bit. I said, all the signs pointed to this and like not didn't occur to me until like a couple years later, someone's like, you know, that guy is like a cult leader, right? And you're like, what? No.
The scary guy things. We all had to stare at?
We're just going to stare at him. It's not that weird. And then, yeah, no, it is that weird.
My biggest thought about this is somebody call Netflix because that's a documentary series right there.
Oh, man, I'd love to see that.
Yeah.
Vice has a really good article about it as well.
Oh, right on.
I'm not a big Vice person, but every once in a while they do surprise me.
Miami Vice was great.
Yeah. Yeah.
Grand Theft Auto Vice. Pretty good. Yeah. Classic.
And Greg, what do you
In Goodfellas where he pops the guy's eye out? Anyway.
Greg, what do you think of, was Walt Disney murdered and did Kurt Russell do it and is Kurt Russell great? Yes or no?
I have a different theory that I would like to propose.
Oh, okay.
He wrote down his name, right? Kurt Russell's name as he was dying. Could it not be that was the body he had chosen to move his consciousness over to?
Ooh. Holy.
We do talk about him being underground and his head being cryogenically frozen. Why not movement of consciousness?
Totally.
Kurt Russell is just, you know, Walt Disney being like, I'm a great actor.
Yeah, like he was a normal guy until then. He's like, I'm going to be a baseball player. And then he came out and he's just like, no, I want to be an actor now.
Yeah.
I like when we can really drill down and solve things here on this podcast.
Yeah, man. But that's a fascinating perspective on it, because he was also like, Elvis had already transferred his mind into Kurt Russell.
Mm.
And then Walt Disney did it. Like, how many people are in there?
Or maybe like Kurt Russell just has the Ding Mach touch and it just took so long for these guys to die.
I didn't touch on the CIA Mobley thing. Apparently that's that could have been a code or like reference to an old case or a location that has to do with the CIA or whatever. And he's like, Kurt Russell, CIA Mobley.
Or there's a person out there called Sia Mobley.
Sia Mobley.
And they're the actual poisoner.
That could also be the secret word to transfer your consciousness into, like, you look them in the eyes. And you say CIA Mobley and just...
You know, we should be careful and not mess around with
that. We should be... Yeah, that's right. We don't want to say that together. It's like Rochambeau, man. You don't do it. you don't play that game. Yeah, I don't know, man. I do love Kurt Russell. I guess I've given my opinion on Escape from LA already. Yeah. So what else is there left to say?
The check is in the mail.
I like that you snuck in one more list of fun facts in the season.
Oh, I had to. Yeah. You know... Man, that guy is so fascinating. And like, what a great career he's had.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Kurt Russell.
You said five fun facts, and there were five fun facts.
And there were six.
Six.
There was a bonus.
Oh my God.
Totally.
Matt, he was on a roll today.
Totally.
Making up for lost facts.
Well, alrighty, pals. That's our third season in the can. Schmap. There's nothing left to do at this point but our own gratuitous pat on the backs. In our next episode, the Conspies. Are we still calling it that? I know Greg had a bit of an issue with that last season. We probably could have come up with something with a bit more lasting power, but that's showbiz. Hey, what happened?
What happened?
What happened? Our next episode is going to be the Conspies. We're going to do our season breakdown, throw out some awards, choose our best theory, choose our best moment of Greg. Our, you know, everything. You can check out all of our past casts and social media stuff at itsconspiracypodcast.com. And we'll see you next week.
Bye.
See you never.